Good afternoon. A very warm welcome to you all at Walton Methodist Church, and to those of you watching online as well, a warm welcome to you to this testimony service of Reverend Sydney Samuel Lake. To those of you watching online, we've had a few technical issues. We hope, and we prayed about it, that there won't be, that it'll all go smoothly and the line won't break, but if the line does fall away, there will be a recording available within 24 hours up on our website for you to watch again if the signal is disrupted. Refreshments will be served in the hall at the back in two rooms. There's, I think there'll be some hot food in the Wesley room on the left and tea and cakes in the main hall. The service today is going to be officiated by Sam Funnell and Adam Payne. And Philip Beasley. Thank you.
Thank you, Ross. And if I can add my welcome to the folks at home and everyone gathered together here today, it is really good for us to be able to gather together on this very special day to celebrate this testimony service along with Sydney Samuel and his family. Just a word of explanation that our Superintendent Minister, Reverend Keith Beckingham, is unable to be with us this afternoon as his wife is unwell. So as we gather, we do think of Keith and Hilary at this time. But we're grateful for a sort of the flexibility of the team in sort of adapting and changing. And George is going to help us out as well. Uncle George, it's good to have you helping us out in leading the service here together this afternoon. So as we come, we recognize that we are in the presence of God and we come to worship together. So let's just take a moment to be still. On this, the day that the Spirit came, we praise you, O God. On this day that the Spirit came, we open ourselves to your encouragement and guidance. On this day of the Spirit, that the Spirit came, the people celebrated, and so we gather and we celebrate together here today. So let's do just that by sharing in our first hymn. Yeah, hopefully you've all got sight of an order of service. You'll see there it's Father of Everlasting Grace. All the hymns we're using, Sydney Samuel's chosen for this special service. So let's stand, let's sing, let's worship God together with these words. Thank you.
Thank you. Please be seated. And I invite you to join along in praying with me the prayers of approach. Lord our God, eternal and wonderful, holy to be trusted, you give life to all. You help those who come to you, and give hope to those who call on you. Set our hearts and minds at peace, that we may bring our prayers to you with confidence and joy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Eternal God and Father, you are the source of all life, the font of all wisdom, the wellspring of all grace. Your days are without end, your loving mercies without number. We depend on you, and we remember your goodness to us and to those who have gone before us. We tell your story in every generation. God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God of Sarah, Rebecca, and Rachel. God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God of a pilgrim people, your church. You are our God, ahead of us, leading us, guiding us, and calling us. You are the Lord God, the all-wise, the all-compassionate. To you we lift up our hearts, and we worship you, one God, ever and ever. In silence, let us call to mind our sins. Holy God, we confess that we failed to be your faithful people. We have not listened to your word, responded to your call, or loved our neighbors. Forgive us, we pray, and free us from joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Merciful God, grant to your people pardon and peace through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord our God, as we rejoice in the ministry of preaching, let the gospel of your Son come to us, not in words alone, but in power and love, that through our life and witness the world may believe, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We say together the prayer that Jesus gave us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours, now.
The traditions of a service such as this is that we take up an offering, and it normally goes towards something that is linked to ministry, because that's what we're celebrating together here this afternoon. So we are going to take up an offering, if we can, for the fund for presbyters and deacons. This is a fund, used to be called the auxiliary fund, but it supports ministers of both our strands of ordained ministry, and so we take those gifts up and dedicate them to God now. Thank you. For all the gifts that you give to us as your people, O God, we give you thanks. And we ask that you would receive these, our gifts, along with our lives, and use them in the power and blessing of your Spirit to share your good news with all the world. We ask this in Christ's precious name. Amen. Now Philip is going to do our Bible reading for us. Thank you.
Our reading this afternoon comes from Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 3, and beginning at verse 7. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having any righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings, by becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this, or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Philip. Before I begin, I'd just like to say what it is a great, such a privilege to be speaking here today. I know that my colleague, Reverend Dr. David Hinchliffe, as chair of district, was deeply saddened not to be able to be present, but he sends his very best greetings to us as a circuit and to you in particular, Sydney Samuel, at this significant moment in your ministerial and vocational journey. And I'm sure wherever he is in his little bit of sabbatical time that he's using up, he's thinking of us at this moment and praying for you and wishing you well. We've just heard in that reading from Philippians, Paul talking about the prize. I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. Now, in this brief little message I'm going to share with you this afternoon, there are going to be lots of words beginning with P, because everywhere I looked, I found more and more of them. Maybe the fact that it's Pentecost, and the Bible reading that we've had today is from Philippians, maybe that meant it was almost inevitable. I don't know. Or maybe it's like the Bader-Meinhof phenomenon, that psychological phenomenon that some of us might have learnt about in various different aspects of things. And if you've done the training on unconscious bias from the equality, diversity and inclusion stuff, it crops up in there. It's something about when you become aware of something, like you buy a car that's yellow, Suddenly, you see yellow cars all over the place. It's a bit like planning a sermon and starting to think about the letter P, and then you find them all over the place. So, a starting word, P, for prize. That's where we're going to start. Now, if I were to ask you, and this is a rhetorical question, so you don't have to answer, unless you want to, of course, did you ever win a prize? And if so, can you remember what the prize was for? I wonder, can you think of something? I struggled. I was thinking about this myself, and I'm thinking, what have I ever won a prize for? I couldn't immediately think of anything. Then I did think of something. Here is my Oxford book of wild flowers, which was presented in this, can you see this beautiful handwriting? My headmaster of my primary school had beautiful italic handwriting and forced us all to try and learn to write with italic script, which is okay if you're a gifted head teacher, but when you're about eight and you have a really scratchy nib, you can imagine what it looked like. It was appalling, really. But anyway, this says, presented to Samantha Funnell. Now, that is not an excuse to start calling me Samantha. I'd just like to point out. Presented to Samantha Funnell by the governors of Sandown Primary School for, wait for it, good conduct, stop laughing, and persistent effort. There's another P there. February 1981. So I did have a prize. I'd forgotten I'd got this book. It could be quite useful now I've remembered I've got it. There we go. A prize. Some prizes are worth having. Others, maybe less so. Maybe if you've thought about prizes that you've won in your past, you can possibly think of some really good ones and some other ones that kind of not so good. Maybe they're the ones we can't remember. I don't know. Some prizes probably are to be actively avoided. Like the time I took part in a guess the weight of a cake competition at my home church in Hastings. Now, I wanted to take part, and because it was a fundraising event, I wanted to, you know, contribute my money and chip in, but it was the kind of cake that I didn't eat. So I didn't really actually want to win it at all. So I therefore guessed a ridiculously heavy weight as my answer, because I thought this was a good way. You know, I've joined in, I've contributed, I've paid my whatever it was, 20p, and I've come up with a weight that the cake couldn't possibly be because it's much, much too heavy. And then I thought, oh dear, I'm going to be in real trouble with the person that made the cake, because they're going to think that I'm implying that their cake is incredibly heavy. So I had to go and find out who made the cake and then go and apologise to them and just explain to them what I'd done. Obviously, in the case of our scripture passage for today, we are looking at a much, much better prize, the best ever, and one that we as Christians strive towards in all our journeys of faith, whether it takes us in the direction of ordained ministry or all the other multiplicity of ways of living out our life with God through Christ in the Spirit's power. Look, there's another P word. I told you, you're going to find them all over the place. When I read this short passage from the letter to the church at Philippi, as Paul seeks to encourage them in their faith and their sharing in the work of the gospel with him and the other servants of Jesus at their time, it speaks to me of how we too, each one of us, whether we're gathered together here in church or whether we're watching at home, we're all called into that same partnership. And what better day than Pentecost to pause to consider how we might do that for just one brief moment. So what does our passage offer us? Well, brace yourselves for an onslaught of P words. Here they come. As part of preparation for our journey, we have a task, just like Paul did, of prioritizing, of what is really precious in our lives. Paul could claim many things that might count in his favour in terms of who he was. After all, he was a circumcised Jewish believer. He was a child born into the tribe of Benjamin. He was a Pharisee concerned with upholding the law. He was zealous in his religious observance, even to the point of persecuting the early church, as he previously believed was right. And he was blameless in terms of his own righteous lifestyle. But all of this, he says, pales into insignificance in comparison with what he gained in knowing and accepting Jesus Christ as his Lord and Saviour. And this shifted his whole perspective. It showed him what was of real and lasting value, that is to say, what is truly precious, and really defined who he was as a person in relationship with God. It gave him his identity as he sought to participate in the works of God in the world and to share in the power that came to him from Jesus' resurrection. And we too are invited, encouraged, exhorted even, to share in this same kind of preparation wherever we are along our journey of life or faith. For us too to prioritize, to gain a deeper, broader perspective of our life lived with and in God's love. So to seek to discover and to learn more about what is really, truly precious. That God would give God's very self for us in Jesus and would conquer death and sin and separation and bring us back to God's very heart, enabling us to participate in what God seeks to do right here, right now, and to enable us to do so with joy and great power, because God makes that possible, because we are God's Pentecost people, aren't we? Yes, we are, right here, right now, today, Walton Methodist Church, about 4:25. Paul then goes on to note that the reality is that it won't all be easy. It's not all downhill or plain sailing, depending on which metaphor you prefer. Sufferings are mentioned, and the idea of us having to persevere in the sometimes painful journeying that constitutes the Christian life. From Paul's opening comments in chapter 1, it's thought that the letter that he wrote to the Philippians was written from prison. And if we read the Acts of the Apostles, we can learn about the many, many trials that came Paul's way in all his travelling. And I wonder if he was also very mindful of those persecutions that he himself had aimed at Jesus' followers before he met with the risen Lord on that road to Damascus. This is the reality for us too. That life following Jesus won't always be easy, whatever particular route it is that we end up travelling. And Jesus never said that it would be. He spoke to his followers then of the sufferings and the persecutions that would come, of the misunderstandings that there would be, and that they needed to carry their cross. Recently, a colleague of mine in the district made me look again at the words of Jesus from John chapter 10, verse 10, which are sometimes rendered as in Jesus saying, "I have come that you might have life and life in all its fullness." And she said to me in our conversation, "I now understand that this means all of life, the good bits and the not so good bits, all of it. That's life in all its fullness." And that's what we get when we choose to follow Jesus. Sometimes it's painful. And that's when we need God's help to let go and to leave some of those things in the past. Like Paul says in verse 13, forgetting what lies behind letting it go so that we can move on, and turning our gaze onwards and upwards, persevering towards that which lies ahead. And that's where Paul comes to the concept of the prize that's really worth persevering towards. Not the cake that you don't really want, or the book that you might have won for good conduct and you've put on a bookshelf and forgotten all about, or maybe some of the things that you thought about when we thought about what prizes we might have won. Paul is focused on the goal ahead of him and presses on in pursuit of the most important and precious of prizes, the heavenly, or in some biblical translations it's rendered, upward call of God in Christ Jesus. What an amazing thing that was for Paul, and is for us too, that God in Christ would call us, each and every one of us, at home, here in the building, and lots of other people who would have loved to have been here this afternoon but can't be with us. God calls all of us to respond, to follow, to be involved with God. What a prize that truly is. It's interesting to me to note that when I looked in one of my commentaries about this passage, there's a note there that the language here is not about a kind of frantic striving after something that we might lose or might not be what we think it will be, as if there was any kind of uncertainty about the outcome. I think it's really reassuring to note that it means that this prize is something we can truly believe in. If you like, the prize becomes a promise. It is ours for the taking. We just need to be faithful, to run our race, to persevere and to pursue it with every fibre of our being. Now, all of these things are true for us as we travel faith's journey, but I think they have been evidently true for you, Sydney Samuel, as you have journeyed through the last 4 years of probation. See, P words all over the place. There's another one, probation. It's almost over. You've had to deal with an awful lot of prioritizing, to discern what was most precious, to keep you focused on your sense of calling, holding on to the love and power of God to guide you through and get you through so, so much. You've had to persevere through what has been at times a painful path, to strive to keep a positive mindset, to leave behind the things of the past and to press on to what would come next, the next challenge, the next bit of work to be submitted, the next committee. You've pursued your path towards the prize, and now that probationary period is almost over, and from this gathering together here, we send you forward from this place, this time and this space, with our love, our best wishes, and above all, our prayers. And just to mark it, I've got a little something for you. It's not a cake or a book. It's just a little something that represents the journey towards the prize.
Thank you.
God bless you.
Thank you.
It's just to wrap it up, keep it safe. Pentecost paper. There, you've got the Trinity in the cross, in the shape of the triangle, and then you've got the path that leads to the prize. As Pentecost people present here in this moment, may each one of us offer God praise and commit ourselves anew to pressing on towards the perfect prize of our individual callings. And may God always come to our aid and accompany us on the way, wherever that journey may lead. Amen. Thinking about how God calls us, we're going to sing about that now in our next hymn. I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, and we get to respond, here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? And if we say, I will go, Lord, if you lead me. Let's stand and sing together. Thank you.
If you're comfortable standing, I invite you to remain doing so as we profess the faith of the church through the Nicene Creed. Let us profess the faith of the church. We believe in one God, Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus.
Sydney Samuel, I'm going to invite you to come and join me. Now, you've had a dry run of this, haven't you?
Yes,
these affirmations that Sydney Samuel is about to make in our midst have already been shared with our colleagues in the presbyteral session of Synod. But it is one of the things that we traditionally do as part of this district testimony service to hear Sydney Samuel commit himself once again to these parts of the ministry to which we are soon to be ordaining you to. Okay. So, Sydney Samuel, I ask you, do you believe and preach our doctrines?
I do.
Do you accept and will you administer our discipline?
I do.
Are you still as convinced of your call to the ministry as you were when you were accepted?
I am.
I'm glad to hear it. Let's pray. O loving God, through whose spirit you call us and set us apart for acts of service, and through whom some are called to ordain ministry in your one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, pour out your blessing on Sydney Samuel as he prepares to be received into full connection and ordained as a presbyter in the Church of Jesus Christ. We pray that day will be one of joy and blessing as, by prayer and the laying on of hands, you will ordain Sydney Samuel to the ministry to which he has been called and tested. May his ministry continue to be blessed. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. We do send you forward with all our love, prayers, and best wishes. And in a little while, we'll hear your testimony. So I invite you to take a seat, and we'll look forward to your testimony in just a moment.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sydney Samuel. Now it's my great pleasure to welcome our colleague, Uncle George Kwam, to come and lead us in our intercessions and thanksgiving. Thank you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace that is from above, and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, and for the life and unity of the church, let us pray to the Lord. That we may worship God in spirit and in truth, let us pray to the Lord. For all ministers of the church and the whole company of God's people, let us pray to the Lord. For the governments of the nations, that they may seek justice and peace for all people, let us pray to the Lord. For our own country, just remember the Platinum celebration. Remember the Queen Elizabeth, her family, subjects, the Commonwealth, and our local community. Let us pray to the Lord. For the sick, remember Keith's wife and all who are poorly. For the afflicted and for prisoners, let us pray to the Lord. For ourselves, that we may truly serve him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light, let us pray to the Lord. That with all who have served God and now at rest, we may enter into the fullness of unending joy, let us pray to the Lord. Almighty God, to whom our needs are known before we ask, help us to ask only what accords with your will, and those good things which we dare not, or in our blindness we cannot ask. Grant us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you, George. So now I'm going to get out of the way and I'm going to hand over to Sydney Samuel, and this is your opportunity to share your testimony. And I'm going to sit over there because otherwise all I can see is the back of your head. Sydney Samuel, come and share your testimony with us. Thank you.
Good afternoon, people of God. My call to ministry could go back to when I was a child, about 7 years old. My grandmother would send me to go around her house to wake up other members of my family so that we assemble and say our morning prayers together. I did not know that that was calling people to God or evangelism. But it started that early. In my late teens, I was involved in a road accident. The vehicle in which I was a passenger rolled down an embankment. As the car rolled, I prayed in my heart, "Oh God, save me." After rescuing my friend, who was the driver, witnesses looked in and around the wrecked car to bring out the passenger, whilst I had come out of the scene unscratched. And I stood looking at the overturned vehicle from the street level. After that incident, I realized that the God that my family worshipped, the God that my mother and grandmother say prayers to, was not just the God of my family, but he was my very own God. And this God saved me when I called for help at the moment of my need. Thereafter, I started a personal relationship with God. My zeal and hunger for God continued. I became an active Christian under the born-again traditions. I sometimes attend 3 services and fellowship on a Sunday, plus several midweek Bible studies and prayer meetings. Months later, I became a teacher and bought a Good News Bible with my first salary. That was my first property as well. Some years later, I was talking to an elderly man in a pub. We discussed the names that people should use to call God. He told me about several names that God should be called. I presented to him that Jesus Christ is the name above all names. And as we parted company, I informed him that I will be traveling from Sierra Leone to the United Kingdom for further studies in accountancy. He replied to me that you will become a minister of religion. Looking back, that was my call to the ordained ministry, discerned by another person for the very first time. After arriving in the United Kingdom, I started worshiping in South London at the Peckham Methodist and Bermondsey Methodist Church, where I was commissioned as a local preacher in 1990. I initially candidated for the ministry around 1992. I did not succeed that time, but I succeeded in completing my accountancy training and worked as a chartered management accountant for over 20 years whilst I served as a local preacher. My journey over those decades was very safe. Then in 2012, I was made redundant. At that time, I was also overshadowed by a call or restlessness to candidate again for ordained ministry. The urge was irrepressible, and I found peace only when I responded with moves towards candidating. After a testing of that call by the Methodist Church, I was accepted to commence ministerial training, and I moved to Queen's Theological Foundation in Birmingham with my family. After some years, I successfully completed my initial ministerial training, and in 2018, I was stationed to this circuit, the Wave Valley Circuit, as a probationer, working chiefly with three churches, Walton, Addleston, and Weybridge Methodist Church. The process of probation over the past years has been very difficult and sometimes good. Hallelujah. You see, we are trained to nuance, you see, so we say one thing this way and we say another thing the other way. Make it level. Often I feel weak and challenged. And what makes it bearable is faith, family support, God's grace, and wait for it, songs, hymns, such as On Christ the Solid Rock I Stand, All Other Ground is Sinking Sand. God, our Father and Mother of Everlasting Grace, that was the first hymn we sang today. And my third favorite hymn of passion was, Lord, it belongs not to my care, whether I die or live, to love thee is my share, and this thy grace must give. Albeit after singing that, after the die or live bit, I will always pray that I live to everlasting life. Admittedly, it is mainly throughout the journey, it is mainly on the recognition that I am a vessel of God serving God's people that I would usually feel strength to carry on. Situations often become easier, especially when I consider that our Creator also has problems dealing with his own people. Moreover, when I recall that I am not the creator, and looking at Moses and his conversations with God, God knows that his people are sometimes very stubborn. Yet he sends Moses and all the prophets and ministers to serve his people, preach the word, and be a shepherd to God's people. Thankfully, God promised that he will be ahead of his servants and will go through all the challenges with his servants. Thus far, I have learned to lean on the faith that unless God goes with me, I am not brave enough to say all will be well. My hopes at present are founded on the belief that at ordination, I will be anointed and filled with the power of God's Holy Spirit to carry out the work that God has already begun in me. I would like to take this opportunity to thank many people as I continue on the journey towards ordination. I thank all the people who have walked alongside me during this very challenging journey. I am sad that some of the people who were around when I started this journey had departed from this life. I thank God for their contributions to my life, and I thank God for the people who continue to stand by me. I particularly recognize the pain that my family regularly experienced alongside me. Thank you, my wife. Thank you, my children. Thank you, all my family. And also thanks to my ecumenical partners and friends in the United Kingdom, Sierra Leone, and in other parts of God's world. Thank you for joining with me. I also thank God for people in the Methodist Church family who had remained loyal and tenacious in giving me their support in the hope that I will succeed. I am grateful to you. I'm grateful to my colleagues in these and other churches I worked with within the circuit. I'm grateful to my colleagues across our district. I say thanks to colleagues for my sending circuit in London. And I say thanks to the many good people that I met during my period of training when I was sent on placement to different churches and circuits in Birmingham and Solihull. I wish to thank several colleagues in the Methodist Church in general, but I can't name you all at this moment. I extend a heartfelt and sincere thanks to my mentor and friend. I extend thanks to the team consisting of my superintendent minister, one of our circuit stewards, and my supervisor and probationer oversight, who accompanied me to the district probationers committee, where our district chair relayed the good news that the committee had voted to recommend me for reception into full connection and ordination. I want to thank members and stewards of this church, the Walton Methodist Church, for working hard to organize this service and to organize the refreshment that follows. I thank our sacred superintendent, my supervisors at Queen's, and my supervisors during my probation. I extend my thanks to our district chair and other colleagues, as well as my friends and many other people for all that they have done to assist this process of my training. I ask for your continued prayers regarding my journey ahead unto probation and unto ordination and as that journey comes into effect, I ask for your prayers on my ministry as a Methodist minister in a lifelong ministry, during which time I hope to focus on a ministry of reconciliation. As Jesus Christ reconciled people to God through the cross and also brought people together, be they Jew or Gentiles, I pray that I may follow in such ministry. Finally, I give thanks to our Almighty God and ask you to join me in singing his glory. Please stand as you're able and let us sing to God be the glory, great things he has done.
I think you can only respond to that with amen.
Amen.
The Lord gives strength to his people. The Lord bless his people with peace.
Amen.
We go into the world to walk in God's life, to rejoice in God's love.
grace.